where right now the body of the 41st president of the United States, George Herbert Walker Bush, is lying in repose at the Bush family church back home in Houston. Now, all night, people have been filing by to pay their respects. Later this morning, a memorial service at the church, St. Martin's Episcopal. It will be President Bush's second memorial following a service yesterday in Washington. For more, we turn to CNN's Jessica Dean in Houston for us.
Good morning, Dave and Christine. We are here at St. Martin's Episcopal Church, where President Bush will lie in repose until 6 o'clock this morning. So they're asking people who'd like to come pay their respects to drive to a nearby church. They're then walked through security. They board buses and are brought here. But that's been a very important thing, important for this community to pay their respects to President Bush. Now, at 10 a.m., again, Central Time, that's when this second funeral will take place. We're expecting to hear from President Bush's grandson, George P. Bush, as well as his former Secretary of State and best friend, James Baker. We'll be following all those developments throughout the morning. Dave and Christine.
Jessica, thanks. As President Bush and his whole family were a strong presence throughout all of Houston, it's no surprise that thousands of mourners, regular Houstonians, lined up, some waiting more than 10 hours for a chance to pay their respects.
I'm so happy that I came. I would have spent 10 hours in line waiting.
George Bush was Houston's president. We wanted to come and pay our respects and honor him.
Houston was the Bush's home, but Washington was where the late president built his career. His state funeral yesterday, held at the National Cathedral, was filled with heartfelt tributes and emotional farewells.
George Herbert Walker Bush was America's last great soldier statesman, a 20th century founding father.
I believe it will be said that no occupant of the Oval Office was more courageous, more principled, and more honorable than George Herbert Walker Bush.
He loved a good joke, the richer the better, and he'd throw his head back and give that great laugh, but he never, ever could remember a punchline. And I mean never.
In his inaugural address, the 41st president of the United States said this: "We cannot hope only to leave our children a bigger car, a bigger bank account. We must hope to give them a sense of what it means to be a loyal friend, a loving parent, a citizen who leaves his home, his neighborhood, and town better than he found it. So through our tears, let us know the blessings of knowing and loving you, a great and noble man, the best father a son or daughter could have. And in our grief, let us smile knowing that Dad is hugging Robin and holding Mom's hand again."
Well done, Mr. President. Robin, George, and Barbara Bush's little daughter died of leukemia at age 3. You know, he spent his lifetime raising a lot of money for MD Anderson Cancer Center and for cancer. This afternoon, President Bush's body will be taken by train to College Station, Texas, where he will be laid to rest at his presidential library. Stay with CNN all day. We're going to have full coverage of President Bush's Texas memorial service and interment.
Meanwhile, a group of bipartisan senators looking to punish Saudi Arabia for its role in the killing of a Washington Post journalist, Jamal Khashoggi. They'll meet today to discuss a deal aimed at suspending arms sales to the Saudis and curtailing U.S. support for the war in Yemen. They're hoping to reach a consensus and bring it to the floor as soon as Monday. It comes after senators were briefed by the CIA director on Khashoggi's killing and came away convinced the Saudi crown prince was involved.
What I do know is that, you know, the CIA director came in and with some analysts and gave the most precise presentation I've ever heard in 12 years. I left there, as I mentioned. Somebody came up today and corrected me on my comments yesterday when I said if he went before a jury, he'd be found guilty in 30 minutes. One of my colleagues came up and said, no, 20.
A deal targeting the Saudis would also be a rebuke of the president. He has downplayed the Khashoggi murder and cast doubt on the role of the Saudi crown prince.
All of Washington, a whirl of speculation this morning. Everyone wants to know what's under those hundreds of black lines redacting key parts of that court filing in the case of one-time National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. Special Counsel Robert Mueller says Flynn provided substantial help in the Russia investigation, but Mueller isn't ready to say yet what that help was. CNN's Sarah Murray has more from Washington.
Good morning, Dave and Christine. The heavily redacted sentencing memo from Michael Flynn, President Trump's former national security advisor, has Washington wondering what special counsel Robert Mueller is holding back. For all we've learned about Flynn's substantial assistance, 19 interviews with law enforcement spanning more than a year, Mueller's filing leaves many questions unanswered. Flynn offered intel for multiple investigations. He cooperated in the investigation into potential coordination between Russians and senior members of the Trump transition and campaign, offering long-term and first-hand insight. What those insights were, that's still unknown. Flynn also provided substantial assistance in a criminal investigation. The rest? Blacked out. As for a third investigation, the details of that one are entirely redacted in the filing. Those blacked out lines causing frenzied speculation as to what or who could still be in the Justice Department's crosshairs. And we're still waiting on at least two other developments this week. Mueller's team, in conjunction with the U.S. Attorney's Office in Manhattan, is expected to file a sentencing memo in the Michael Cohen case and respond to his request for no prison time. And on Friday, we're expecting an explanation from Mueller on what former Trump campaign chairman Paul Manafort lied to investigators about, jeopardizing his cooperation agreement. So still a very busy week ahead. Back to you guys.
Oh, indeed. Sarah Murray, thank you. We may learn much more about President Trump's finances once the Trump Organization responds to subpoenas served Wednesday. The Attorneys General of Maryland and the District of Columbia demanding tax records, profit and loss statements, and other records of the president's personal taxes are not part of that subpoena. A federal judge on Monday gave the go-ahead in a lawsuit by Maryland and D.C. The suit claims the president is violating the Constitution's ban on payments from foreign or domestic governments to federal office holders. The Washington Post reported yesterday lobbyists for Saudi Arabia paid for at least 500 stays at the Trump Hotel in Washington over 3 months shortly after the president's election.
The Senate Judiciary Committee is scrapping a meeting today to advance more of the president's picks for the lower courts. An aide to Chairman Chuck Grassley says it's because Republican Senator Jeff Flake is not backing off his threat. Flake vows to vote against all pending judicial nominees until he gets a floor vote on a bill that would protect the special counsel Robert Mueller.
We can solve this easily. Let's just have a vote. Let's just have a vote. We need to approve some more judges. It'd be great. But this has to be priority now. It really has to be.
The committee has canceled meetings 2 weeks in a row, delaying 22 nominees from floor consideration by the end of the year.
The chief financial officer of Chinese tech giant Huawei has been arrested in Canada. She now faces extradition to the United States. According to Canadian Justice Department spokesman Ian McLeod, Meng Wanzhou was arrested in Vancouver on Saturday, December 1st. A Canadian judge has agreed to bar both police and prosecutors from publicly releasing information about this case now. The publication ban prevents media from reporting on any evidence presented by the U.S. or charges expected to be filed by the DOJ against her. Now, back in April, the Wall Street Journal reported the U.S. Justice Department was investigating whether Huawei violated U.S. sanctions on Iran. A spokesperson for Huawei said it, quote, complies with all applicable laws and regulations where it operates, including applicable export control and sanction laws and regulations of the UN, US, and EU. Now, a spokesperson for the Chinese embassy in Canada issued a statement urging the US and Canada to, quote, immediately correct the wrongdoing and restore the personal freedom of Ms. Meng Wanzhou. Huawei, which sells smartphones and telecom equipment around the world, has been facing increased scrutiny in the U.S. and other countries, where officials have warned of potential national security risks from even using these products. The U.S. is concerned the Chinese government could be using Huawei's networking technology to spy on Americans. A bail hearing has been set for Friday. The U.S. Justice Department declined to comment Wednesday, but certainly some international and business.